Good afternoon, members. We welcome you all at this webinar. Today's webinar is meant for addressing various issues relating to name availability, your doubts, your concern, for which the ICSI has made many representations to the ministry. And the another one will be filing of return with regard to MSME. These both issues will be addressed by the eminent, you know, persons from the ministry. Mr. Sasiraj Dara, the Joint Director from Ministry of Corporate Affairs, welcome you, Dara Sahab.
Thank you.
And Mr. Pranav Chaturvedi is Deputy Director from MCA. Welcome you, Pranav ji. We are also having Mr. Manish Gupta, the Central Council member, who will interact while the webinar will go on. But it is requested that as many queries as you can raise via the connectivity, so that your purpose is solved and the queries relating to, especially relating to name availability, are solved then and there. Specific queries which are useful for all the members should be asked, not that specific query that you have made an application for your client for name availability are to be avoided. We wish all the very best for this webinar and welcome all the, you know, officers from the ministry and Manish ji to take forward this webinar a success. Request Mr. Manish Gupta to take up this webinar and address the issues one by one intermittently after Sasiraj Dara ji has addressed. Thank you very much. All the very best for this webinar. Thank you. Manish ji, over to you.
Thank you, Dikshit ji. At the outset, I welcome you all to the webinar being organized by ICSI. And for this webinar, we have taken up the name availability guideline, which was released on 10th of May 2019 only. And these guidelines are being framed after the much discussion and deliberation at the MCA level. I am happy to share that many from the ICSI, we have forwarded so many feedback and suggestions for framing these particular guidelines and rules. And all those suggestions are being taken up and part of the rules now. On our request only, we discuss it with Mr. Dara that our stakeholders are facing so many issues and concerns with respect to the MSME. Although we had two webinars on MSME in the recent past, but he kindly agreed to answer all those queries on MSME also in today's webinar. Without wasting much of your time, let us straight away go to the guidelines on name availability, and would request Sasi Daraji to kindly take up the name availability guidelines first. Then we'll be taking the questions on the name availability. Would request our stakeholders and viewers, kindly send your queries on the name availability. Don't send any SRN with respect to the CRC concerns and rejections being done by the CRC. We will be taking up the general queries only, not the specific queries with respect to any of the name being rejected by CRC. Over to you, Dara ji.
Thank you, Dikshit ji. Thank you, Manish Gupta ji. I would like to thank ICSI and all the members of the institute for attending this webinar. We have come up with the new name availability rules. This was done in consultation with ICSI and all other stakeholders. They were put up for public consultation, and after due deliberations in the ministry, we have come up with these rules. Good thought has gone into these rules. What are the highlights and what are the changes we have made into these rules? We will request my colleague Mr. Pranay Chaturvedi, Deputy Director in the Policy Division of the Ministry, to take up each and every point for the clarity of the members. Over to you, Pranay.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, distinguished members of ICSI. It's a pleasure for me to address members of ICSI. The topic for today is the name availability rules. These are rules, so to say. So this has come up in the Companies Incorporation 5th Amendment rules. Now, the philosophy behind these rules is to make things clear. There were too many subjective aspects in the rules. Now, the entire philosophy behind framing these rules is to clear those things, is to make it as objective as possible. So if we see the Companies Act Companies Act has got two provisions, primarily two provisions under Section 4, which provides the grounds on which a name of a company has to be given. These are sections, subsection 2 of subsection 4 and subsection 3 of subsection 4 once again. Now, what are the criteria which has to be kept in mind while deciding whether a name has to be allowed or not? Section 4, subsection 2 says that a name shall not be identical or resemble too nearly to the name of an existing company. Now, identical is something which all of us understand. But what is resemble too nearly to the name of an existing company is something which was not clear in the rules prior to 10th May. So, our objective was to clarify as to what is too nearly resembling. What is too nearly resembling? This was our objective. Second is such thing that its usage will constitute an offence. Third is undesirable in the opinion of the central government. Next section, the next provision says words or expressions which are connected with the government or words and expressions as may be prescribed shall not be given unless there is a prior permission of the central government. Now, these are primarily the provisions under the Companies Act which are important for the purpose of name availability. Now, what are the basic changes that have been done in this case by these rules? The changes are, can be summarized in this slide. What we have done is, the existing Rule 8 has been split up into three parts. Rule 8, Rule 8A and Rule 8B. Now, Rule 8 is now laying down the test of what is too nearly resembling. This test was missing in the earlier rules. So, the Rule 8, the new Rule 8 is entirely dedicated to lay down a test, a clear test to determine as to what is too nearly resembling. Rule 8A, on the other hand, lists out the conditions on account of which a name would be deemed as undesirable. Rule 8B provides a list of expressions and words which have to be used only after a prior approval of the central government. And another important feature which is there in these amendments, that we have liberally used illustrations to explain the meaning and intent of the rules which have been laid down. So, coming to the first thing, Rule 8. Rule 8 talks about a test. The test is to determine what is too nearly resembling. Now, this test actually works like an equation. How does this equation function? You need to see what is the given name, what are the name that you are applying, and then you need to take the existing name. Now, how will you compare these two? What you will do is that you will disregard the items which are specifically provided in Rule 8 subrule 2. You have to disregard all these items and then see whether applied name and existing name are same. In case they are same, then they cannot be given. Then they shall be deemed to be too nearly resembling. Once they are too nearly resembling, they cannot be given. But in case A and A is not equal to B, then this name B, A, which is the applied name, can be provided. So it is very easy to understand that the entire effort has been made to clarify this thing. This thing which was as of now not very clear as to what would constitute too nearly resembling. All efforts have been made to lay down an objective test, so that people at large understand as to what would be the criteria to determine resemblance of names. These are certain examples which you will find in Rule 8, Subrule 2, certain things which you need to disregard while comparing the names, use of definite and indefinite articles, so on and so forth. Now, another important feature is, it is very clearly provided in the rules that what all things will be allowed, in a sense that they would not be disregarded in case there is a board resolution. So, in case you have a board resolution, certain items will not be disregarded. In case they are not disregarded, then A will not be equal to B. In our previous slide, A will not be equal to B. If A is not equal to B, you can have A. A is your applied name. You can actually have a successful claim over A. Another important feature of these amendments is that we have tried to clarify the issue regarding trademark. Now, the previous rule stated that trademark can be given even if it is in the application stage. That is, we were considering the trademarks which are yet to materialize. A right was provided to those applicants who are yet to get a right in law, whose right is yet to materialize in law. So, this has been now taken care of. The present rules are now protecting the rights of only the registered trademark holders, not the applications, which are only under the application stage. Those rights are not protected. Another very important thing which we have done is, we have put the reference of classes in this rule. Now, this was actually implicit, but still we have made it very clear that a trademark has to be seen with reference to the classes, with respect to the activities. So, this has been clarified in the rule. Another important thing in this rule is that it starts by saying save as provided in section 35 of the Trademark Act. Now, section 35 of the Trademark Act protects bona fide use of trademark. There are cases where even a registered trademark holder will not have a right over his trademark. Those cases are provided in section 35 of the Trademark Act. For example, if you want to use your own name, or you want to describe the quality of the goods or services that you are going to use. So, in such cases, this section 35 gives you a bona fide use. Now, this bona fide use is something which is being now recognized in the current rules. Coming to the next important change that has taken place in these rules is the issue of general names. Now, this was there in the earlier rules, but the definition of general name was not very clear. To get over this situation, what we have done is, now we have tried to define this. And not only, we have not just defined it, we have explained it through explanations. We have given three broad explanations to define as to what is descriptive name. The new term that is used for general name is descriptive name. So, this has been now made very clear as to what are the grounds on which a particular name would be considered to be a descriptive name. Once a name is categorized as a descriptive name, then your right over that name will not exist. You will have no right over that name. So, what we have done is, we have explained this through three explanations. We are saying that do not use commonly used words, only commonly used words to describe an activity in your name. So, if your name is only Silk Manufacturing Private Limited, it is so common that you ought not use this name. You need to have a name which does not only consist of commonly used words. So, what is commonly used words has been described through three explanations. And further, we have illustrations in this rule to clarify as to what would constitute a descriptive name and also what would not constitute a descriptive name. So, this I would like to say that by liberally using the illustrations in these rules, we have tried to clear the intent behind framing of these rules, so that these examples would actually serve as guidelines for people who want to incorporate their companies, who want to apply for new names for their companies, or even in cases where they want to change the name of their existing companies. So, this I would like to say in brief. I have summarized what are the basic changes that have taken place by virtue of this amendment to the rules. Sir, how do we proceed now?
First, you complete the.
This is my presentation.
We'll go in bit in detail. So we'll go rule by rule also, so that they can understand
for the benefit of
the stakeholders, because these are more day-to-day used rules.
Okay.
I think rules are there in the system also. You can go ahead.
The illustration you can explain in detail.
Otherwise, I'll explain in detail. That's not a. So, till Pranay gets over, I'll tell you what are the basic changes. Now, we have defined what is too closely resembling. That is part one. So, what is regarded as too closely resembling and what is regarded as too nearly not resembling, which we have tried to bring out in rule 8 itself under sub rule 2. And in 8A, we have brought out the conditions which under which the names are considered as undesirable, and 8B, we will be taking up those rules which require the approval of central government. Over to you, Pranav.
So, again, to come back to the rules, if we see Rule 8, now Rule 8, as I said, lays down a clear test to determine as to what would constitute a situation where the names are too nearly resembling. So, the two things which are important for us to determine as to what is an identical name and what is too nearly resembling name. Now, all of us will have no confusion as to what is identical. Identical, as the name suggests, it is identical. There is no difference between the two names. But to determine as to what too nearly resembling is, for that we had to lay down a test. Now, the section Rule 8 actually lays down that test. It says a name applied for shall be deemed to resemble too nearly with the name of an existing company. Just few moments back, I explained this through an equation, A is equal to B. Now, if and only if, after comparing the name applied for with the name of an existing company, by disregarding the matters set out in subrule 2, the names are same. So, what are we required to do? We are required to take the name that we are applying, and then we need to compare it with an existing name. How do we do this? We first of all, in case of an existing name or as well as the applied name, we disregard the matters which are provided in subrule 2. And after disregarding, we compare the names. In case we find that the names are same after disregarding, then we reach a conclusion that these two names are too nearly resembling and so they cannot be given. But however, if we find that these two names are not same after disregarding the matters which are provided in subrule 2, then our conclusion would be that these two names are not too nearly resembling and these names can be given. The applied name can be given. So now to just read out the matters which have been provided in subrule 2 of Rule 8, first is very clear the suffixes which are associated with the name: private limited, OPC, IFSC, producer limited, unlimited, LLP, company and co, corporation. All those things would be ignored, they would be disregarded when we are comparing the names. These things will not be taken into account. A plural or singular form of name in one or both names, this would again be disregarded.
That means you mean to say if singular or plural are used in A or B of your equation, yeah, applied name and this name, both will be compared
and it would be disregarded.
It would be disregarded.
So as the illustration points out, it says that in case there is an existing or an applied name which is Green Technology, it would be deemed that this name Green Technology and Greens Technology and Greens Technologies are same. There is no difference between Green Technology, Greens Technology and Greens Technologies.
So they are too closely resembling.
They are too closely resembling. So once we compare these two names, we try and disregard. Once we disregard, we find that now they are same. Since they are same, so they cannot be given.
Required to be disregarded.
Yeah. If you see the third illustration under this rule, this is very important. Now, what we are saying is we are considering the singular and plural form of names. But sometimes there are acronyms used in a name, SM computers. Now, but this is not same as SMS computers. Now, SMS, the last S in this SMS cannot be considered to be a plural form of SM. SM is an acronym. It is a short form of some, it's an abbreviation. So, this SM computer and SMS computer is not same. There is a distinction between these two.
So, here we would like to highlight that not only the illustrations which are given in, we have not given illustrations which say what is too closely. We have even given illustrations which clearly say how you can get a name also, just not disregarding also. The third example is stating that, that is SM Computers Limited is not similar to SMS Computers. The illustrations which we have tried to put out in all these rules are of this kind. Not only positive, we have all, not only negative, what is to be disregarded and how it is to be disregarded, what is to be regarded also is given in the examples.
The next one, type and case of letters, spacing between the letters, punctuation marks, special characters used in one or both names. So the illustrations in this case makes it very clear that the essential difference between the names, ones which are applied for and the existing name, are so very nominal. They are only, the difference is only with regard to spacing or with respect to a punctuation mark which is put in between. So these changes have to be disregarded. Once you disregard and then you compare, you will find that both the names are same. So once the equation comes up, if A is equal to B, then the name cannot be given. Now, use of different tenses in one or both names. Here again, the illustration makes it very clear. Ascend solutions is same as ascended solutions and ascending solutions limited. Speak English solutions is same as spoken English solutions limited. The next one is based on phonetics. So, this we have seen that phonetically, if a name is similar, then that name cannot be given. So, this has also been taken care of, and the illustrations in this regard give a list of names where, due to phonetics, the names would be considered to be too nearly resembling. And since they would be considered to be too nearly resembling, so those names cannot be given. The next is use of host name such as www or a domain extension such as net, org, dot or com in one or both names. So, I would like all of you to see the second illustration which is given in this case. It says Supreme Ultra Solutions is not the same as ultrasolutions.com limited. So, if you see, this is important. Ultrasolutions.com, we have put a com here, but then again this is Supreme Ultra Solutions. So, there is a clear distinction between these two names, and therefore there is a distinction between these two names and cannot be regarded as too nearly resembling. The order of words, the next one is the order of words in the name. Here again, if you see, both the illustrations are given in such a fashion so that, as sir was pointing out, you will have a clear idea of which names can be given and which names cannot be given. So, both the illustrations have been made with that point of view in mind. So, Ravi Builders and Contractors is same as Ravi Contractors and Builders. What is happening is you are switching contractor and builders. So, it is essentially the same name. But if you come to the next illustration, it says Ravi Builders and Contractors is not same as Ravi Shankar Builders and Contractors. So, if you see that this is not a case where only the words are being switched. This is a case where some addition has been done to the name. So, this is a new name. Use of definite or indefinite article in one or both names. This again is very clear. If you see the second illustration in this case, again, Isha Industries Limited is not the same as Anisha Industries Limited. Here, an in Anisha does not signify an article. An is not an article. Anisha is a separate name, Isha is a separate name. So, these two are separate names, and therefore, the rule of disregarding will not operate. I mean, even if you disregard, then also you will find that these two names are different. Next one that we come to is a case where there is a slight variation in the spelling of two names, including a grammatical variation thereof. So, if we see, this is on account of the fact that certain spellings, that certain words can have more than one spellings. So, this rule primarily addresses that situation. So, if you see the second illustration again, I am emphasizing on the second illustration once again in this case, you will find that disk solution, DISC, disk solutions is same as DISK solutions, because disk and disk is essentially the same thing, but it is not same as disco solutions. Disco solution is a new word altogether, and therefore, even the rule of disregarding does not mean that you will not have the name. You can certainly have the name in this case. Next is complete translation or transliteration and not part thereof of an existing name in Hindi or in English. Here again, as sir was pointing out, we have made sure that you have both the ideas, the ways in which you can have the name and the ways in which your names is liable for rejection. So, if you see the first illustration, it is National Electricity Corporation Limited. Now, this is same as Rashtriya Vidyut Nigam Limited, because what we are essentially doing is that we are translating an English name into a Hindi name. National Electricity Corporation Limited is translated as Rashtriya Vidyut Nigam Limited. But if you see the next illustration, it says Hike Construction Limited is not the same as Hike Nirman Limited. Now, if we read the rule once again, it says complete translation. So, if there is a translation in part, then you can actually have the advantage of it. So, if there is a part translation, you can actually have the advantage of it and you will not be hit by this rule. So, this is actually working in your favor. So, instead of translating a word in its entirety, if you translate a part of it, you can have the benefit of it. The next one, if we see, it says addition of the name of a place to an existing name which does not contain the name of any place. Now, this is very interesting. If Salvage Industry, Salvage Technologies Limited is an existing name, it is same as Salvage Technologies Limited and Salvage Delhi Technologies Limited. Now, what does this rule say? It says that if you are adding the name of a place to an existing name which did not contain the name of my place. So, if my name is Salvage Technologies and you want to take Salvage Technologies Delhi, you cannot have it unless I give a board resolution to you. You must have a board resolution from me. Whereas, if I have restricted my name by, if you see the second illustration, it says Retro Pharmaceuticals Ranchi Limited. Now, what I have done is, I have restricted the scope of my operations by adding the word Ranchi. So, if I am myself saying that my name is Retro Pharmaceuticals Ranchi Limited, then if you want to have Retro Pharmaceuticals Chennai Limited, there is no problem. So, once I limit the scope of my operations, at least in my name, by using the name of a place in the name, then someone else can actually add another place, name of a place in his name, and he can actually stake a claim over that name. Whereas, if I don't write the name of a place in my name, then for writing or for inserting the name of a place in that name, you need to have a prior board resolution. The last one in this series for this rule is addition, deletion or modification of numerals or expressions denoting numerals in an existing name unless the numerals represents any brand. So, if there is an existing name, Thunder Services Limited, it would be construed that this name is same as Thunder 11 Services or One Thunder Services Limited. Similarly, Style 11 Garments is same as Style Garments and Style 12 Garments. So, the entire idea is that in an existing name, you cannot add, delete or modify the numerals. You cannot add, delete or modify the numerals. However, there is a saving grace. In case you want your numerals are identifying a brand. For example, 24/7 is a brand. So, in case you want to put 24/7 in your name, and you are actually associated with 24/7, then this rule will not apply in your case because you are actually representing a brand. So, that protection would be given. Otherwise, these numerals would be disregarded. Now, proviso again makes it very clear that in case of certain clauses, and these clauses are expressly mentioned in the proviso, F to H and K and L, in these cases, there would be no, it would not be disregarded while comparing the name, provided you have produced a board resolution from the existing company. So, this is the structure of Rule 8. The entire idea of Rule 8 is to make a thing as subjective as two nearly resembling name clear for people through usage of illustrations so that it makes the task of the stakeholders easier so that they have a clear picture of what is the intent behind these rules. If we see the next rule, undesirable name, there are very few changes which have taken place in Rule 8A. Very few changes. Essentially, they represent the features which were already there in the previous rules. One important thing which I had explained is, if you see Clause B of Subrule 1, this is regarding trademark. I will just read out. It says, save as provided in Section 35 of the Trademarks Act, the name includes a trademark. Now, if I go back, the clause starts by saying save as provided in section 35. So, this is a protection. This is, as I was referring to in my presentation, that bona fide use has been protected. In case of a bona fide use, even the registered trademark holder will not be able to stop you from getting a name. In case you can show that there is a bona fide use. So, save as provided in section 35 of the Trademark Act, the name includes a trademark registered under the Trademark Act and the rules framed thereunder in the same class of goods or services in which the activity of the company is being carried out or is proposed to be carried out. This again, if you see, I had mentioned in my presentation, the reference to the class of goods and services is now embedded in the rules. This was always implicit, but now this has been made explicit. Unless the consent of the owner or applicant for registration of the trademark, as the case may be, has been obtained, what we need to see is that we need to only go by the, we have to only see whether the name includes a registered trademark. The next ones, if you go through, I mean, these ones, there is essentially not much difference in these rules, in these clauses. These were always there.
We have added explanation over here.
We have added explanation in clause S, where we have stated as to what are descriptive names. In my presentation, I was referring to this when I said that what is too general was something which was not very clear to very number of people. So, what we have done is now we have clarified and we have used a new phrase. We are calling it descriptive names. So, this is a new phrase which we are using. We are calling it descriptive names, which by which we mean that where the name merely consists of commonly used words to describe an activity. So, this is something which is not allowed. A descriptive name would be considered to be undesirable under Rule 8A. And the explanations are making it clear as to what is the meaning of the word commonly used words. It refers to the use of generic expressions which may be used by any other company to describe its trade. Another important thing which is used, which is stated here, is that while determining whether a name is descriptive or not, the objects of the proposed company or the order of the words appearing in the name shall not be relevant. So, you can take an example, say there is a name which is, say, Ashok Hotel or Hotel Ashok. The order of the words in the name is not relevant. So, simply because if you have put hotel as a prefix and Ashok thereafter, will not mean that your name would become descriptive. The order of the words are not relevant and the objects of the proposed company are also not relevant. What is relevant in this case is that you must not be using commonly used words, which is provided in explanation A. Now, explanation C further states that the name shall not be deemed to be descriptive where commonly used words are used in addition to other words in the name. This is again a favorable condition which is given to people who want to apply for new names or want to rectify or change existing names. So, what has been said is that in case you say something more or in case your name has words other than commonly used words, then your name shall not be deemed to be descriptive. There are 5 clauses for illustrations, and within these illustrations also we have given several illustrations. So, liberally we have provided explanations because it was given to understand that these rules, or this provision rather, was susceptible to too many interpretations. The first one is clear. It says that the names Silk Manufacturers Private Limited and Manufacturers Silk Limited are descriptive names as they merely describe an activity which may also be carried out by any other company and the order of the words is not relevant. So, as I was mentioning, the order of the words in the name is not important. What is important is that you must be using only commonly used words. In case you are only using commonly used words, then the name would be deemed to be a descriptive name. The next clause says the names Computer World, Food Star, Tour Hub or House of Chocolate Limited are not descriptive, as these names do not merely consist of commonly used words. So Computer World is not a commonly used word. It's a, you are combining two distinct words which actually does not have any meaning. Food Star is a word which is not only commonly used word. So there were certain issues with respect to these kind of names. Now this illustration sets it right. It says that these kind of names ought not be regarded as descriptive or general. The third one says the names Technical Vista Limited or Vista Technical are not descriptive, as the names do not merely consist of commonly used words and the order of the name of the words is not relevant while determining whether a name is descriptive. Fourth one, the name Drinking Water Plant is a descriptive name, even if the object of the company is not related to making drinking water plant. As if you read the explanation, it is very clear the object of the name and the order of the words are not relevant. So even if you are not actually into the business of drinking water plant, still the name actually only consists of an activity, and these words, all of them, the entire expression taken together is very generic. It is susceptible to use by any person for describing his or her activity. Therefore, the objects will be disregarded and this would be considered to be a descriptive name. The last illustration in this case is again Silk Wise Manufacturers Private Limited is not descriptive. This again, if you read explanation C, it says that if you use something over and above, I mean other than commonly used words, if you are using, then your name would not be regarded as descriptive. So what essentially you are doing is you have put a word wise in between. Silk, instead of silk manufacturers, you are saying silk wise manufacturers. So this means that your name no longer remains descriptive and your application may be considered for approval. So these are essentially the changes which have taken place. 8B also is actually taken out from the erstwhile rule 8 sub rule 6, where we have given a list of names, list of words and expressions which require the previous approval of the central government. So for, if you want to have any of these words in your name, you require a previous approval of the central government before having these expressions in your name.
To summarize what Pranay has told, basically we have tried to define what is identical. Identical is no, there is no need for us to define what is called identical. Identical means what is identical only. Then there was gaps in the name rules where names were, names, most of the names we had issues from stakeholders telling that most of the names were getting rejected because of use of the words name too general or something like that. So we have revisited the rules, we have made out the rules very clearly. Now we have brought out the new term called resembling too nearly to the name of an existing company. The concept is we have tried to describe it in the form of an equation where it is called A is equal to B, where A is the proposed name and B is the existing name. When you are making that equation called A is equal to B, you have to disregard whatever is there, whatever is provided in 8 sub rule 2, which clearly says all these things like private limited, limited, the articles, you are using singular, plural, whatever is described in rule 8 sub rule 2 have to be disregarded. Then A has to be compared with B. If A is equal to B, then you will not get it. If A is not equal to B, then that name is considered as, that name is not resembling too closely to an existing name. Then we have come up with 8A, which clearly, 8B, which says what is central government approvals. There were lots of confusion from stakeholders whether this word requires, whether I am using the word board, whether it requires the approval of the central government or not. We have set it out clearly by dividing the rule. Previously there was only one rule. We have divided it into three rules so that people clearly know. A means it is checking the test of too closely resembling. B is with respect to names which are undesirable as specified in section 4. and C is wherever you require the approval of the central government. I think with this, we will go ahead with the questions.
Before taking questions, let me first appreciate the efforts put in by the MCA team. They have very categorically defined each and everything within the rules with the help of the illustrations and examples. And now the issues with respect to the two general, which is being generally being marked as rejection by the CRC people, would be sorted out. Let us straight away go to the questions which we have received from our stakeholders. The first question is, what is the criteria of getting the word global?
Before answering any questions, I would like to tell all I request all the members of this institute, please do not pose any questions with respect to any SRN or I have applied for this name, can I get this name? Please try, these rules are exhaustive, illustrations are given, both what can be given. For the first time, you might have noticed in this rules, ministry has brought out something which can be allowed. Everywhere previously in all the old rules, which in previous rules we have used to tell, this is not desirable, this cannot be allowed. This illustrations we have brought, what can be allowed also. Please try to understand and please try to limit yourself to what are the rules we brought out on 10th May. So, we will not be answering any questions with respect to any specific name. We will be trying to answer, we will be reading your question and trying to answer it within the ambit of these rules. Please. Global, you can read the rule. Rule is very clear. It depends on how you are using the word global, whether it is falling under rule 8, 8A or 8B. It depends on that. Just by asking the word whether global can be given cannot be answered.
There is no criteria as such with respect to the authorized capital now. No. Earlier it was there.
No, there was no, there is no concept of authorized capital. Pranay has made it very clear in his rules that there is no concept of your object. While we are checking this, in the rule 8B explanations, he has made it clear what we are thinking about it.
Actually, people are still having the old rules in their
That's
mind.
What I told. That's what
global,
in the
international carry the minimum authorized capital requirements.
Yeah,
now
global,
there is no such requirement within
global the industries, enterprises used to have
any
it.
Name can be held with any amount of capital.
Any amount of authorized capital. That is the reason I have told my introduction that first go through these rules.
Right.
There is a very sea change in the rules which have come out now.
Second question is, what specifically are the changes we have discussed?
Main changes I'll tell you is we have divided the rules into three parts. One, where you'll put it to a test of two nearly resembling. Then it says what names are undesirable, and third is what names require approval of the central government. Apart from this, the major change which we have brought out is with regard to the trademark. Previously, it says the rule used to say if a name includes a trademark. So, many of the rejections were there that if the name included one word of the trademark also was anywhere a part of the name, it used to get rejected. So, for the purpose of clarity, we have brought out the rule on trademark, which clearly tells that trademark should be in that particular class. We have even given protection to the trademark holder, as well as it will be only checked against that particular class, and it is not includes that word which was there called a name includes a trademark has been removed, and a whole new rule has come up for trademark. Please read that rule before going ahead.
So the next question is with respect to the illustration only. Somebody has given the example that they are looking for Enclave Service Station Private Limited, and the company with the existing name Enclave Engineering Services.
I would advise our esteemed members to read rule 8, 1 and 2.
Right.
Apply the equation and check this. You will immediately understand whether this can be given or not. Here I would also like to tell our members that before making any suggestions, please go through the rules properly. Just by applying any name and testing whether that can be got or not from CRC is not the correct way of doing it.
Okay, sir. Let's move. India Word is available for the incorporation of private limited company and LLP.
Pranay?
Yes, as such, there is no restriction. In the rule, we are not saying anything, but what we are saying is that there is something called Section 3 of the Emblems Act. So I would request people to go through the Emblems Act also and to see as to what are the requirements under the Emblems
Act. Before applying for it, please read Section 4.
The context is also provided in the Emblems Act. So request members to go through this act also once.
Whether the guidelines are also applicable to Nidhi company?
Yes, they are applicable to all classes.
To all kinds of company, maybe Nidhi, producer, all sort of companies.
All companies.
Whether guidelines are also applicable to LLP?
Separate set of rules are applicable to LLPs.
Not as of now. I mean, these are only for companies.
These are only for the companies.
Yes.
Separate
this rules, because it is guided, LLP is a different act, right, and there are different rules for name availability of LLP.
Actually, also, I would request members not to use the word guidelines, because these are no longer guidelines. Guidelines were there in 2011.
Right.
These are now rules.
From 2014 onwards, these are rules.
Yeah, these are rules, and these rules have been made under the Act, under the Companies Act.
For LLP, you need to see the separate guidelines
LLP
which are
rules
being formed under the LLP Act.
Yep.
Whether activity of the proposed company would be checked while approving the name as per the amended name availability rules.
You have made
activity
it clear, like
company.
While in case of trademark, we have specified that you have to see only in that particular class. In case of descriptive names, we are saying it is not required to be seen as to what activity you are performing. So these things we have explained during our
so it is
already.
Basically you have to go through all these three rules,
right?
A, 8A and 8B, understand, and then this can be answered. Just posing a question.
The next question is with respect to a trademark, whether labels containing pictures and word registered as trademark or SM would be matched for similarity.
Trademark rule is very clear.
Yeah.
Here that would not be
label, I don't think so. It has to be the word mark.
Word mark only.
Yeah.
What is taken is only word.
But sometimes
marks.
Both are registered, so people have to be very careful while they are verifying this. Sometimes both the label as well as the word mark is
label
registered.
Label design are not being considered here.
Label
but
design.
We have to go by the words only.
We are only checking word mark.
We are only checking the word
we
mark.
We are not getting into labels and other things. Trademarks.
Whether the proposed name would be checked with the trademark which are abandoned, pending, in objection and suspended.
This is abundantly clear. Previously there was confusions with regard to trademarks. Many confusions were there because the rule said if
applied
the
for
name includes a trademark. Now we have made it very clear. If it is in an application stage, it will not be considered. The rule, please, I would request
it says only registered.
Pranay to go through the rule once and give an explanation
actually,
so that
earlier it was
members
like
can understand what is
trademark registered or applied for.
Now this or applied for has been removed.
Or applied
we'll,
for has
we'll
been
go
removed.
Through the rule once
so
again.
So what, yeah.
And
save,
it.
As I pointed out, it starts by giving a saving grace. It says save as provided in Section 35 of the Trademark Act. So it essentially protects the people who want to bona fidely use a word which is connected with their object or which is connected with their own name. So those bona fide usage is protected firstly in this clause. Then it says the name includes a trademark registered under the Trademark Act. Now this is very significant.
Only
we are only talking about registered trademark and the rules framed there under and in the same class of goods or services. So if we read this entire rule, it makes it very clear that bona fide use of the words is now protected by virtue of Section 35 of the Trademark Act. You are only required to see registered trademarks and you are only required to see the activity in the class of a particular trademark. You are not required to see the activity in any other class which is not concerned with your with the activity of the company that you propose to set up. So these are things which are very clear in the rule.
Right. This is the good thing that the applied for has been removed because many of the times the CRC people are rejecting on the basis of the application.
They were rejecting only based on what was
on the rule.
The rule.
Right.
The rule said if the name includes a trademark which is there or applied for.
Right.
So based on that, so we have made it very clear here, the trademark should be registered in the same class.
Same class. Having the same set of activities,
yes,
as well. That is the good thing done by MCA. Next question is whether the word company, they are looking for the word company is prohibited from the being used in the name of the proposed company. Please clarify, as there is no rule or section which says so.
When there is no rule or section which says so.
Actually, CRC is rejecting the companies which having the word company in it. That might be because of the earlier guidelines or the rules.
No, it is not because of the earlier guidelines. That's what I told you. We'll limit our discussions only to these rules, because if we go and penetrate into what are getting rejected.
As far as these rules are concerned
and the Act is concerned,
this word can be
Act given. Specifies where you can use the word company. I request our members to go through the Act. In Act, it is specifically written company can be used for one particular class of companies only.
OPC.
So, next question.
OPC and producer, these two classes are allowed. Right. In Rule 8B, certain words and expression can be used only after obtaining previous approval of central government. What is the procedure for obtaining that approval?
You can send a mail to Policy Division of the Ministry. Policy Division of the Ministry accords approvals for any words which are required for previous approval of the central government.
This approval is required to be taken by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs or from the concerned ministry, if say MSME is being used, or
it is from the Ministry of Corporate Affairs.
Corporate Affairs only.
Yes.
And how much time it generally takes?
1 to 2 days.
1 to 2 days. That means you people are granting the approvals in the cases which are genuine. What precautions one should take while applying the name?
Very good question. I would appreciate the member who has asked this question. To answer this question, I think I have to read many of the provisions of the Companies Act. I will limit myself to it. First, read. It is a good opportunity. Good question. Why I told it is a good question is many of the promoters who are applying do not go through the provisions of the Companies Act.
True.
Please go through Section 4, Section 7 of the Companies Act, where it is very clear. Where if you apply for a name also, there is a liability associated with it. So before applying for something, before coming to the ministry for applying for something, please refer to Section 4, where there are liabilities associated with the actions which you initiate in MCA. Further, you have to go through the rules, Rule 8. Then you have to also go through what is written in Emblems Act, what are the words restricted in Emblems Act. Then you have to also use the services provided in MCA website for checking of trademark. There are what classes of trademark are separately defined in trademark website. There is a link available in MCA website. Please go and check what are the classes. Define your object, it falls in which class. Then come back to your trademark search. Use your word, put the class, you will understand whether there are any trademarks registered on it or not. Then you can go ahead. But I would request all the members to please go through Section 4 and understand the liabilities associated.
Before applying anything.
Yes. These are the main precautions. Of course, nothing said and done. 447, 448 is
always applicable. Okay. In case any application is being filed for name approval, can it be rectified before its approval or after?
As of now, as per the Companies Incorporation Rules 2014, you can apply for a name in run service. And you will be given one more opportunity without any fees to rectify the name with which...
If rejected.
No, not
if resubmitted.
If sent for resubmission.
Yes. Sent for resubmission.
If sent for resubmission, that is the opportunity which is given in this. The next question is how much time it has taken for approval of a name. It is 1 day. It is 1 day from the date on which you have applied. That is, day includes working day.
Okay.
Next.
Is there any helpline for understanding the reasons for rejection and justifying the case?
The helpline, here I would like to take an opportunity and tell you that ministry has an full-fledged grievance redressal mechanism which is there. Go to the MCA website, www.mca.gov.in. On the home page, on the right-hand corner, there are buttons which says CRC grievance. If you go to the grievance, there is a whole set of guidelines for grievances which you have to do. Apart from this, there is an helpline number which is 0124-483-2500, which is the general helpline number. There, the moment you dial the number, it will ask you if you have a query on CRC or name availability or incorporation, please dial 1. If you dial 1, it will take you to the specialized persons who can answer your queries, who are experts in Companies Act, who will guide you properly about what are the rejections and how it is rejected. Here I would like to caution all the members, please do not go to them for your professional advice. Please do not ask them why my name is not getting rejected. Before you ask that question, why my name is not getting rejected, please go through the rules, because whatever rejections or approvals are there are based purely on the rules set out in Companies Act and Companies Incorporation Rules 2014. Nothing is done beyond that. If you ask him why it is written in the rule, they cannot answer your question. They cannot answer what whether this name should have got, it should have got, I did not get. Please go through them. The other thing is regarding grievous redressal. If you have any grievance, there is a separate email ID created for grievance redressal. Please use that email ID. Do the grievance. If your grievance is not resolved, there is a further appeal for your grievance also, which is set out in that grievance redressal.
CRC escalation email ID is also
there. Is a CLC escalation email ID also. There is a CRC grievance email ID also. There is an appeal for CRC grievance ID also. There is a document, whole set of document placed on the website, prominently just below that helpline number. Or just above that strike off or director's disqualifications, there is a tab called CRC grievances.
Okay.
Please go through that. There is a PDF document. There are email IDs mentioned. There are phone numbers mentioned. Please use it.
Since
we are in this forum, I would like to request all the members of this institute not to shoot out mails to all senior officers just for a name. And most of the cases we observe that the time of the senior officials is getting wasted, and ultimately we understand that there is no, the names are rejected based on the rules framed there under. So please use the grievance redressal mechanism, because it will reach the particular person who can effectively give a redressal to your grievance. Just by shooting mails to all addresses or all email IDs available on the website is not going to resolve your problem. Use the grievance redressal mechanism for that.
Just to add in this case, that help desk is being the customer care center and not being managed by the CRC people. So you have to ask your question very wisely, not to ask any irrelevant question which are out of
not irrelevant scope. Question. You should not ask them why I am not getting this name.
Yes.
Before asking them why I have not got this name, what is the rejection which you got? Nowadays, all rejections of CRC are standardized. You will clearly know what under which rule you have it has been rejected. If you ask him why it has been rejected under that rule, there cannot be any explanation. It is for the members to understand and do it.
And there won't be any answer with respect to who is dealing with that particular matter or not. There would be no answers given by the help desk that who are the concerned person who have rejected your case. So it would be a general answer which would be given by the help desk. Whether these guidelines are applicable in case of new name after merger?
Yes.
For everything, these guidelines require
sometimes to be in case of merger, certain directions are issued by the court.
Yes.
So those directions have to be taken into account as well. So in case any particular direction is issued by the court,
sometimes Pranay has pointed out very good point here. Many companies who are going for amalgamation and mergers include one of their point of amalgamation or merger or demerger as a name which they want to use it future. I would request all the members, mostly members of either of the institute are associated with the companies, and mostly a company secretary is associated at the time of mergers and amalgamations. Please mind the rules which are framed here. Please do not go out of this.
Right.
While making an application, while making a request in your amalgamation and merger applications, please follow these guidelines also.
So let me reframe this particular question. Sometimes a company is looking for a name in the case of mergers. Transfer company which got merged with the transferee company, they are looking for the name of the transferor company. Now that transfer company name is blocked and is being written as amalgamated within the master data. Then how to get that particular name? Because every time CRC people are rejecting and that is not being covered within these guidelines, then how to...
In that particular case, if you can get a specific direction from
NCLT. Direction is always there because that is part of the scheme.
I would not like to extend this question. Mm-hmm. I would like to answer it in one simple way.
Right.
when your name says you cannot be allowed an identical name, identical, how can you go and get a similar direction? We have to understand. That's why my opening sentence was, when these requests in the mergers and amalgamations are being made, we have to understand that these name rule guidelines, it should not be violative of these name rule guidelines.
So one should avoid all those things in the scheme itself. Right. Whether the name guidelines are applicable for a new name only or also for the change of name?
It is for new name as well as change of name.
For everything. Short forms are allowed for name approvals or not?
Name rules are very clear in this. Name rules are very clear in this.
We went through one of the illustration, SM computer and SMS computer. So those things were discussed during the presentation which we made.
This is next question is based on that only. Rule A2E. Whether ABC Limited is same as ABCA Limited, ABCA Private Limited or ABCB Limited, ABCB Private Limited or ABCD, ABCD Private Limited.
Okay, next question.
Name is reserved for a period of 20 days from the date of approval of registrar of companies or such other period as may be prescribed. Now, in case of Section 8 company, this is a practical difficulty.
Okay, we understood your difficulty at ministry. There were many representations on this. We are working on this representations. But we did not find any, anyway, we are working on it. NEMAVIL takes 1 day, INC-12 takes 1 day and incorporation takes maximum 2 days. I don't think so there should be any problem. But however, ministry is trying to devise a new mechanism for Section 8 company incorporations.
Okay.
In that line with great. What are the changes which we made for LLP incorporation?
Because INC-12 generally takes 15 to 20 days.
No, it won't take 15 to 20 days. It takes 3 days. But anyway, we are trying to make some, procedural changes in this.
Great. All name rejections criteria to be applied at the first instance still. This seems to be a suggestion given by one of the stakeholders.
Suggestion. My suggestion to our member is, we have noted your suggestion. We would request you please first go through the rules and then apply the name or suggest the name to the stakeholders or the persons who are promoters who are approaching you before understanding or understandingly if you are applying and telling that has to be done. It is very, what can I say? Anyway, with your question, I can answer only this, that what can be checked is what you have applied. What you have applied and got resubmission and again you have made any changes, the person who's checking the second time cannot go back and check the first one. So, I don't think so there is any answer to be given for this.
Another suggestion is with respect to the renewal of name facility should be reintroduced.
There is no provision called renewal of name in Companies
Earlier
Act.
It was there.
There is no provisions in Companies Act.
Sir, we need to file the application again and getting a name
Act
renewed.
Act doesn't say any rule about that or neither Act says anything.
That was in the old Act. The name already approved or rejected if applied again, it's basically based on the CRC system.
There is a question, when we apply for a name of a holding company for formation of a subsidiary company with a single word differentiate, it gets rejected. The problem is being faced by the companies desirous of incorporating wholly owned subsidiary companies with common word from promoter company name even after submitting NOC. I think there is a rule on this. Pranay, would you like to?
Now we have explained in which cases you can give board resolution and your names would be approved. So, this was actually explained during our presentation that we have actually specifically listed out the clauses. These clauses have been very clearly listed out where we are saying that...
I'll repeat those clauses. It is something written like provided that this is in 8 sub-rule 2. There is a proviso after the last L which is there that says provided that clauses from F to H and clauses from K to L shall not be disregarded while comparing the names if a NOC by way of a board resolution has been provided by an existing company. That means if an existing company is giving an NOC, sub-rule 8 sub-rule 2 is not applicable.
Yeah.
Sir, would like to extend this particular question to a little bit. Say if a holding company is having 4 subsidiaries and they are now going for the incorporation of one more subsidiary, means the fifth one. The NOC by way of board resolution is required from the
all
holding
four.
Itself
all
or
four.
All four companies.
Yes.
That means the board resolution is required to be attached from all the group companies, including the holding and subsidiary companies. The next question is whether while applying these rules, coined words.
Because the words used here in the rule are very precisely clear. It says provided by an existing company.
Right.
It doesn't say holding company.
Whether while applying these rules, coined words would be separated and checked for resemblance. For example, whether the word like Ocean King, Ocean Water would be separated.
This is a very specific question. However, this is specifically covered in sub-rule 2 of 8. Please check that rule and go ahead.
So, sometimes the special character which is being generally used by having the shift key and
these
the
characters
numbers,
are not now not
even
allowed.
The Roman and is not allowed.
Not allowed.
Generally, companies are looking
there
for the
Roman
and.
There is a rule which we have brought out very specifically.
Right. Now, that is not allowed.
That is not allowed.
We have also received few more questions on it. Can a company be rejected on ground that the activity is similar to the activity of other another company? Example, ABC Solution and Solution Technologies.
It is very very clear. There is no rule like this. It seems to be a hypothetical
yes.
question.
Can the word international be used while applying the name?
Yes.
There is
it depends on rule, all three is
we had already
rules
it.
You have to
yes.
understand and go ahead. Just by asking the word whether international can be allowed or not cannot be
in
answered.
In isolation, this question cannot be
cannot
answered.
Be answered.
Yeah. There is a lot of confusion regarding sectoral approval. Names because the sectoral authorities do not consider what MCA has directed.
There is a specifically rule. Please read the rule. There is no change in the rule with respect to sectoral requirements. There it is told if you have a sectoral approval, please give. Otherwise, please give a declaration.
Declaration that
automatically
it would be approved
yes,
post incorporation
yes,
of the company.
Yes. People forget to attach the declaration and.
Yeah, just would like to add that the stakeholders are required to have the authorized capital based on the sectoral requirements. Sometimes people are coming with the NBFC companies and having the paid up authorized capital of 1 lakh rupees only. In that case, the CRC would be looking for minimum 2 crores of the authorized capital because unless until you are having 2 crores, your registration can't be done there.
Now, I'll read out the rule for
yes.
you. The proposed that rule is rule 8A. It is P. The proposed name includes words such as insurance, bank, stock exchange, venture capital, asset management, nidhi, mutual fund, etc. Unless a declaration is submitted, it is told, it is telling declaration. It is not asking you for a sectoral NOC from a sectoral this thing. Unless a declaration is submitted by the applicant that the requirement mandated by the respective regulators such as blah, blah, blah have been complied with, it will be a.
But that must be for the new company incorporation when the company is already in existence.
Rules are applicable for new as well as existing companies.
Okay, even in case of the existing company, they can give the declaration and get the name. Okay, there is law that is done. If a company named Excellent Builders is already existing, will the name Excellent Pharmacy be considered for approval?
It depends. Just by asking that word, I cannot tell you whether excellent is there or not. It depends. You have to put it to the test of rule 8, sub rule 2, then check whether A is equal to B, then tell.
Also, there could be an issue where that it's a question of trademark
also.
So many things are involved. That's why it's not possible to answer individual queries with respect to name availability, specific instances.
But going by this only, this can be allowed. If there is no other...
No comments.
Okay. Is there any additional requirement for using group and holding in the reserving names? Because CRC have rejected few of the names based on group and holdings.
There is a specific sub-rule for this. Maybe before the end of this, if I could, I'll read it and tell you.
Right. While conducting a trademark search, are we to consider only the class applicable to the company's activities or we have to consider all classes?
This has been answered in this session only.
Right.
And the rule is now very explicit. I mean, clearly saying as to what is to be considered and
only the activity.
Only
the concerned activity
class
is required to be checked.
Yeah.
Can I have the name ABC Cold Storage Private Limited for a company with object shoe business? Is it mandatory to show the object of the company in its name?
This again is not specifically provided.
There is no provision for that. Mm. This amendment has come in way back in 26 January 2016 itself,
right.
Where the name rules were amended. So,
no further requirement of
the esteemed member is not aware of it.
If the registered trademark holder has not renewed his trademark in the prescribed period, shall it be considered as a label for the new application?
It is answered. It should be registered.
Registered. Just change of proposition.
Just a mere representation of that existing trademark as abandoned, objected,
but it was
expired.
Once registered. Abandoned.
That's what I'm telling
was
you. I'm
once
making
registered.
It very clear. Abandoned, objected, expired. Which if we go to the trademark search, if we put in word as well as the class, it will list out all the whatever is there in that.
True.
Which includes objected, abandoned, expired. Only we will be considering, the rule makes it clear that we will be considering only
registered one.
And not even what is there as applied for.
The change of the proposition of existing name is allowed. For example, instead of two in the existing name, can we use of for the new name?
Very generic query.
For registering chit fund company also, it is required to get prior approval of the at the time of filing name application. If so, without getting the name approval, how to promoter get the, that has already been answered. Secretarial regulator's declaration can be submitted in this regard. When a foreign company is wanting to establish a company in India, what documents of the company would you need? In one of the application, MCA has asked for the PAN of the foreign company, and since the foreign company did not have any PAN, the name was not provided. Seems to be a specific query from the stakeholders.
Here I would like to highlight basics. That is, if you are asking for a name of an existing company and you are not giving a board resolutions, then you cannot go back and blame X, Y or Z telling that it has not been done. If you are applying for a name or a board resolution or a letter from a foreign company, it has to follow that procedure that is apostille, notarized or...
And that has been very specifically given in the act itself.
So if you do not follow and it gets rejected, rules cannot be blamed for that.
True.
There is a specific rule in companies incorporation rule for this.
Right. The next question is, when we applied for one name with the word starting Lebanon or any other name of the country, the system shows error saying the word is required central government approval. Then how to... go for
the, you have to apply to policy division of the ministry.
To the ministry itself.
Yes.
No need to go for the embassy of that particular country. It would be applied by the approved by the ministry only, Ministry of Corporate Affairs. That is required to be sent through CG1.
No, you have to send it as a mail.
Only the mail to the policy department.
Policy division.
The words holding or investment in the name needs prior approval of the company does not fit in NBFC or CIC.
Please read the rule. There is a specific rule for this. It is etc. after that, after investments, financial activities, viz.
True.
It is not clear why you would like to suggest that your activity is only an investment in your name and you don't want to run an NBFC. Because this, for this, a separate rule is provided that in case you are wanting, if you want to use the word investment in your name, then you must have investment as your activity. For this,
and
the rule is very specific.
You must get yourself registered with NBFC.
Yeah. So, if you want to do the business of investment, why not be an NBFC?
Do these rules apply to the existing companies which are desirous of changing their name? If a company already has the word financial corporation in its name and it wants to add new name, does it still have to get central government approval?
Is there space between it or not? Finance and corporation.
Yes, space.
Yeah, then yes.
Then yes, if the financial corporation is being used as a single word, then no, as answered by Daraji. Okay, for MSME, MSME.
Because now previously there was a confusion, financial and corporation was a confusion, which was cleared earlier also. Now that rule reads as financial corporation and like.
And
there
like.
Is a specific rule.
These other questions are with respect to MSME. Any other questions? So, anything you would like to conclude for name approvals?
You can give the conclusion.
Yeah. As I had explained earlier, The entire basis of framing these rules was very clear. The idea was to make it as objective as possible and to address all the areas of concern. The areas of concern, as we have tried to project during this presentation, were issues relating to what is too nearly resembling name, what are the ways in which trademark in a particular name has to be considered, and what about general names. So during the course of this presentation, we have explained the steps which we have taken to modify these rules so that these rules become objective. It becomes easy for people to make an application based on understanding of these rules, and it becomes easy for both parties, for the person who's applying for the name and as well as for the person who's checking the particular name on the basis of these rules. So as such, this was the intent behind making these rules. I hope these rules would be of some use. It would clear the confusion which was prevailing to certain extent earlier, and this would perhaps be a good step in ease of doing business. It would enable people to incorporate companies easily, and these applications would be like addressed to the benefit of all people.
I hope the stakeholders are benefited with the discussion we just had on the name approval rules. We have briefed you earlier that we would be taking certain queries and questions on the MSME filing. As the due date is on 30th of May, all the companies who have outstanding dues with respect to the MSMEs are required to file the one-time return as well as the half-yearly return by 30th of May 2019. So we have requested the MCA team to take up this particular thing additionally within this webinar, and they have kindly agreed to take few questions on it. We have already received few questions on MSME filings. Let me take the issues one by one with Mr. Dara and Mr. Panay. So let's start on MSME.
Before we start, I'll just give one foreword of MSME.
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
There are two returns to be filed. One is one-time return, which is for 3 years. Then there is one, people are getting confused with this. See, myself also, I'm getting confused. That one-time return is for DPT-3. Here in MSME, there are two returns, one-time return as well as a half-yearly return. Half-yearly return, here people are having main confusions about the financial year. The financial year which you are using is not relevant, or the financial year which you are applicable in Companies Act is totally different from the financial year which is being used by MSME. This financial year is guided by the MSME Act, not Companies Act. Here the financial half-yearly return means from April to September and October to March. It is very clear, April to September and October to March, two returns, two half-yearly returns. If you are following a different financial year other than that specified in Companies Act, that is April to March, for all purposes, this is two returns, half-yearly returns from April to September and October to March. We can go on.
Sir, the one of the question is with respect to the date of the invoice, because we have to take the entries on the basis of the invoice date.
Yes.
We have to take the invoice date or date of the receipt of the invoice by the company?
There is an agreement between MSME and the company, and MSME Act, the other day we have read out the provisions of MSME right. Act, where it is very clear which date is to be reckoned as date, whether it is the date of supply of goods or services or the data specified. There were examples that in some cases MSME has gone into an agreement with the company for payment beyond 45 days.
Right.
So for reckoning, for all purposes of reckoning the due date would be the date which is agreed by the MSME and not the 45 days. So everything depends on the agreement, what is written in the agreement between the MSME and the company. So, which date has to be reckoned, whether the date of delivery or date of confirmation from the company, everything is written in the agreement, and which MCA is not a party, and these questions can be well answered by the particular company itself, because it is in hold of that agreement which speaks about all these
conditions. There is no such agreement with the vendor.
If there is no such agreement, then Act prevails over it. There is an Act,
MSME
Act,
which says 45 days
from the date of supply of goods or services
we have to take the supply of the date or invoice date?
Supply date.
Due date ke liye.
What is written in MSME Act? It supply. Is better to go back and refer to MSME Act or any clarifications issued by MSME Act with respect to this due date.
Right. So, for the purpose of the half-yearly returns, say the goods were supplied way back on 20th of August 2018 because we have to take October to March half year. Goods were supplied in the month of August, 20th of August, and the 45 days would complete within the half year. So, we have to take that particular invoice in our…
Yes, you have to take.
There would be no difference. It would be like whether the due or received, goods are received or
simple,
due for payment.
It is very simple. Whether 45 days have expired from the date of supply of goods or services. If it has expired, then you have to, as on the due date of that return, you have to mention how many such cases are there where it has exceeded 45 days.
Okay. In that, that means we have to go by the 45th day. If that 45th day is within the half year,
yes,
then we have to take in the half year return.
No, if it has crossed 45 days,
yes,
you have to take.
The payment is outstanding. In any case, payment is outstanding, that is required to be reflected.
46th day is within that half year, you have to mention in this return. If it falls in the next half year, you have to report it in the next half year. If it is a delay beyond 45 days.
Sir, what would be the situation when the MSME got itself registered after delivery of goods, supply of the services, then only they themselves registered with the MSME, the what would be the situation, whether all those MSMEs are required to be covered within the return? At the time of supply, they were not MSME.
The answer is, you have to refer to MSME Act, because what it speaks, it is guided, this return itself is bound by provisions of MSME,
right,
not by the provisions of
MCA. So, we have to refer
the… We
have
facilitated MSME.
Right. I would suggest to go with the compliance only,
yeah,
in that case. Multiple invoices, but the consolidated…
There is a very big question about this, that I am having more than 100 entries,
right,
or I am having more than 1000 entries, 2000 entries. As you know, both half-yearly return and one-time return, there is no fee associated with half-yearly return and one-time return. Any number of MSME forms you file, system will be accepting. There is no maximum cap on number of MSME returns that can be filed by one particular company for one particular half year. However, there are some liabilities associated with section of that Companies Act that prevail. However, there is no upper limit on how many number of forms you can file for one particular half year. So, if you have 1000 entries, if you want to file 11 forms, they are allowed. If you want to file 15 forms, they are allowed.
Sir, going by this, are we from the ministry side planning to have a consolidated form in case of the multiple forms?
No.
No.
As of now, no.
As of now, no. So, we have to go by the 99
as
entries
have,
per form.
As I have told you, we have tried to accommodate 99 entries. Beyond 99, you have to file it. Another return.
Right.
Again, there is no fee associated with the first return or the second return or any multiple returns. So, there is as such no liability associated with regard to fees of filing multiple
right
forms.
Any apprehension with respect to the late filing after 30th of May?
I think
apart from
to
the
wait,
405.
We have to wait for any circulars we get from.
We are looking
Ministry
for the extension on this.
No extension.
Any
there is nothing called extension. There is no liability.
MSME.
That's what I told you.
But the late,
there is no
late filing is always an offence.
Late filing is always
violation.
An offence. It is clearly provided in the Act. What is the penalty associated with late filing of an MSME? One form. It is clearly laid down. Please go through the
okay
section. However, multiple forms you can file.
Multiple forms can be filed. Okay. If a company is under IBC in which CIRP has been initiated, then how to comply with the provisions?
The person who's there in the place of the board,
IRP,
who replaces the board,
but his signatures are not valid, not registered with the MCA. That is a technical.
Please go to the concerned ROC and get it registered.
It cannot be registered.
I have no idea. Then we have to go to IBC first.
Financial year we have already discussed. Please advise whether MSME form 1 is to be filed for companies incorporated during the financial year 18-19.
Yes. If you have completed half yearly, it is nowhere concerned with your 18 months which is reckoned in Companies Act.
Right.
This is a return which has to be filed half yearly, two returns in 1 year. There is no concept of whether it is incorporated in which year. If your half year
if the company is incorporated within January 19 only, even in that case, that company is required to file.
Yes, it's required to file, and 45 days have lapsed, you have to file MSME 1.
This one is required your attention particularly. What is the last date for filing?
There is MSME? No extension.
Half yearly return.
There is no extension.
It is a confusion there in the minds of the stakeholders, because the when you deployed the MSME fund form, it was for the one-time return. It was categorically stated that it is for the one-time return only. Then how to get the idea about that the half-yearly returns are also required to be filed by the 30th of May?
Good question. A person who has filed MSME return will not have this question, because there are two separate radio buttons. The day we have explained you, there are separate radio buttons for this. There is one radio button is for the initial return, the other radio button is for the half yearly return. The moment you click the initial radio button return, the period, financial year period, will be one time return. If you click on the other radio button, it is a half yearly return. So there is no confusion as of now. I would like to make it clear, there is no extension being considered for MSME. Please file your returns in time. There is no additional fees associated, so it is advisable you complete filing of your MSME.
At the earliest.
At the earliest. Don't wait for the last date also.
And for the extension as well.
You are not going to get any extension in this.
Financial year. Please confirm whether MSME 1 required to be filed by the company who having outstanding amount of MSME parties as on 22nd of January and 31st of March, but less than 45 days.
No, not required.
In that case, nothing is required to be filed with MCA. We are having entries more than 200 transactions, but form is taking only 99 entries.
As I have told, it's a free form. Please use three forms in case you have 200 transactions.
For reckoning the 45 days, should the trigger date be the date of invoice or the date of receipt of invoice by the company?
This is very clear. You have to go by the agreement which you have entered.
Agreement or in absence of agreement?
In absence of agreement, the Act MSME. Is very clear on it.
What are the payment terms to be considered for reporting in the form? If payment terms with MSME supplier is 15 days and paid beyond 15 days, but before 45 days, do we need to report it?
Yes. That's what I told you.
45 days is the maximum limit.
Maximum.
Which is being provided by the MSME Act.
MSME Act provides 45 days. However, if you have an agreement between the company and the MSME for a period lesser than 45 days, then that period will be considered. If you have beyond it,
then MSME Act will provide. In form MSME on field 3B, financial year from to 2 in the initial report.
Yeah, this
what
I have
to mention.
Made it very clear that there are two types of things which you can file in MSME. One is the initial MSME return and the other is the half yearly return. This gets activated in case if you file initial return.
So next question is with respect to the days we have discussed, 45 days. Half yearly return as on 31st March. Payment is outstanding to suppliers, however, that is not due between 1st October to 31st March. Still, we need to report.
No. It is very clear, 45 days should have crossed.
So, it has crossed. Payment is outstanding to suppliers, however.
It is not due between, he is telling it is not due.
By way of agreement or by way of.
That's what I told you, you have to check it yourself. Generic queries like this cannot be answered.
Kindly clarify that in MSME form, financial year to financial
year from 2 is applicable in case of initial return, the half yearly, that is April to September and October to March, are there for half yearly returns. There are two separate radio buttons for this. The financial year from 2 gets activated based on the radio button.
Form remains the same for the one time return as well as for the half yearly returns.
Any likelihood of filing date of MSME to be extended? No. In half yearly return, what needs to be filed from 1st October 18 to 31st March 19? Outstanding for more than 45 days? Yes, it is outstanding for more than 45 days.
Irrespective of the payments.
Irrespective of the payments.
there is no proper path to export details in the form from Excel or Word file.
No, no, there is nothing like that. Beyond
that is required
99,
to be
you have to file, there are 99 fields given in it. Beyond 99 fields, you have to file a fresh form. I have observed that for half yearly MSME return, firstly identify the bill that is received during October to March, and then secondly check whether those bill payments within 45 days or not. Even if bill received on 1st October 2018 and paid on 20th December, those bills be counted for due of 45 days. A specific situation, please take professional guidance. As per a notification dated 2nd November 2018 issued by the Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises, every company with a turnover of more than 500 crores has to register with trade receivables discounting system platform set up by RBI. I think there is no question here what he is intending. He is asking whether we are a company registered as NBFC-CIC with RBI. Please clarify whether NBFC company which does not fall under the category mentioned in the above circular is required to register under TREDS platform. I don't think so. We can answer this. This is very specific to TR.
So this, as far as this is a relevant question, I would say that as far as the requirement is concerned, the requirement is not there. It is not mandatory for you to, because the mandatory requirement is only there in case the threshold of 500 crore is involved for turnover. However, I would suggest people that in case they can register on this platform, they should go ahead and register on this platform, because this is about creating a seamless process between the MSME supplier and the company, on one side. And there is a financial institution or bank involved as a third party. What happens in this case is that this is a concept of bill discounting. What you do is, this MSME supplier would upload his invoice on this portal. This invoice would be ratified by the company. The company will say that yes, this is the invoice. What would happen in this case is that the bank would step in and the bank would give the payment to the MSME, and this payment would be given at a lesser rate. Like say you wanted 100 rupees, but this 100 rupees you will get after 60 days. So now you can have say 90 rupees today. So the MSME supplier is also benefited by this arrangement. The company would also be benefited by this arrangement, because the requirement of paying the money to MSME is now gone. The money has to be paid to the bank or the financial institution in the terms, in accordance with the terms of arrangement which are like agreed to between the parties. So this is a win-win situation. In turn, the company has to give 100 rupees after the period as, I mean, contracted between the parties. So this TREDS platform, I suppose, is a win-win situation for companies. It is not mandatory for all kinds of companies, but in case people come and register on these platforms and they try and do transactions with at least MSME players on these platform, I suppose it would be of benefit to many people and also to the MSME industry as a whole, because the issue of working capital, which is the main reason why this firm was introduced in the first place, would also be solved. This, the entire reason behind introducing this firm is to address the issue of working capital. Why these MSME players are getting, or these companies or entities are getting their payment after a prolonged period of time. So if people register on these platform, you would actually be doing a national service.
That would be in their own interest.
It would be in their own interest. So I would suggest people not to see as to whether it is binding or not. This is an idea to create a seamless environment where transactions can happen at a good pace. So I would request people to consider this option.
Great, sir.
Thank you, Pranay.
We are unable to identify who is small and micro. In the absence, how to file the return with the amount? In many companies, account set is for MSME and not for MSME alone, MSE alone.
It is very specific to the company. That is for the company to identify, check, register whether they are registered MSME.
But if, corporates are really struggling with that, I would say.
They have to take up this, I think at institutional level, you have to take it up with MSME.
Right. Because they have sent the letters to all the concerned parties, whether you people are registered
with
them.
You have to take it up with the concerned MSME minister at institutional level.
For sure, we will be taking it up.
Inform MSME 1 field 3B financial year from to in initial report what to be mentioned, that is from 1st April 2014 to 2019. What is the due date to be considered to enter in column? Specify the due date from which it is due. It depends on your agreement or 45 days from the date of providing of goods or services. For reckoning 45 days, should the trigger date of invoice or the date of receipt of invoice by the company, it depends on your agreement again. Next question is, in half yearly return for October to March 2019 should be abolished as there seems no rationale when initial and half yearly, why same due date for filing? Also, what would be rational when initial return cover most of the period and no rational to file again? I think he is trying to get confused between DPT 3 as well as right. MSME.
He is also mentioning ease of doing business and all other things.
He has combined both the DPT 3 as well as requirements of DPT 3 as well as MSME form.
Sir, just for the sake of the stakeholders, can you please highlight for the purpose of the initial return and
for the whole period of financial years up to the cutoff period, and half yearly is a continuous process. This is only one time exercise where you will take all the details of all outstanding
dues as on 22nd of January.
As on 22nd of January.
Only the
and
outstanding.
After the, only the outstanding.
More than 45 days.
More than 45 days.
This is actually, as sir explained, this is actually based on the concept of stock and flow.
Right.
First of all, we need to know as to what is there in our stock. And then only we can reckon as to
what is there,
what is about to come in future.
Right.
So it is based on the concept of stock and flow.
There is another question, as per webinar of ICSI held on 24-5, the financial year particulars to be mentioned in MSME bond should be financial year as defined in Companies Act or different financial year as adopted. In this regard, we have certain points. For initial record, the total outstanding amount, it is as on 22nd January 2019, whatever be the financial years, from 14 up to 22nd January 2019, how many financial years you have. You have to, for regular half yearly returns, again it is April to September and October to.
For the initial, we have to select first four.
Whatever financial years you are following, whether it is four.
In any case, we have to provide the details of the
outstanding
for more than 45 days. It hardly makes any difference what you are selecting.
How many financial years you are selecting?
If that amount is outstanding, you have to
report it.
Right. Regular return, we have already discussed. We have.
Any other questions?
Few more questions, sir. While considering the transactions for first half year, is it required to check whether the amount is outstanding on 1st October 2018 or only those transactions which are occurring during the half year period?
Even 1st October 2018.
We have to check whether the outstanding as on 1st October or
45 days. Criteria is 45 days, nothing else. Very simple.
Which date is to be mentioned under point 4, last column, specify the date from which amount is due.
It depends on
whether the date of the invoice is, yeah. Or
everybody is having this confusion whether yes. It's the date of the invoice
or the 45th day.
The day you cross the amount is due beyond 45 days is the date, whatever date
or the agreed amount if the lesser period.
Yes,
so that simply means that 45th day we have to take into consideration for the purpose of date of amount due, date due. On which the amount due. We have to take the 45th day.
Work back.
Fair enough. Should it be the date of expectance related to that only? Which data is to be considered for half yearly return, October 18 to March 19? Whether invoice raised during the half year period, whose payment is due beyond 45 days, or all amounts outstanding beyond 45 days during the half year?
All amounts outstanding beyond 45 days. Very clear.
Irrespective of the invoices. However, you have to put the details as per the invoices, because you cannot collect two invoices into the single entry. all invoices raised financial year 18-19 whose 45 days falls within the, yes. If there are more than 200 entries, we have already covered this. An enterprise registered as a small enterprise under the MSME, originated in June 2005 and got Udyog Adhihar number in February 2019 with effect from June 2005, whether for the services rendered during 2007 to 2018 by that enterprise of which payment are still outstanding. Protection of the MSME Act regarding the payments of services as well as compound interest with monthly rest on that pending amount at 3 times of the bank rate notified whether will be available. They are trying to say that the services were provided in the year 2007 to 18 and payments are outstanding for the long period and the registration was done in the month of February 2019 only.
Better consult MSME.
This is actually a specific question,
specific question with respect to MSME.
Act only.
Act only.
Again, the same thing. Vendor get registered himself on February 2019 after learning the developments in the MSMEs. That's it, sir. Anything? That's all from the queries which we have received from the stakeholders. I must thank the MCA team led by Daraji and Panne for answering each and every queries being raised by the stakeholders. They are always available for any of the help and assistance required by the institute. This particular webinar is being suggested by the MCA only, and Daraji only suggested on the last day of webinar on 24th May that let us have a webinar on name approval rules which are being recently notified. And let me tell you, friends, we will be having our next webinar on INC 22A very soon. And we will be notifying the dates in that respect as well to all the concerned stakeholders in the days to come. I would like to thank on behalf of ICSI, Panneji, who has spared his valuable time and come all the way from MCA to share his knowledge and the thought process behind framing these guidelines. Would like to present a planter to Mr. Panne for his valuable time. Thank you very much, sir, for gracing the occasion.
Thank you.
Would also like to present a planter to Daraji.
Thank you.
For sparing his valuable time. He is always available for the institute and always ready to help us. Thank you very much, sir, for gracing the occasion.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, stakeholders. Do send in your request and being conducted by ICSI. Thank you. Thanks to all.